Good morning, my brothers and sisters. Perhaps good afternoon, or perhaps even good evening. But Ian and myself, once again, we count it a joy, a privilege, a delight to come into your homes, perhaps even into your cell groups, or who knows, even into your church. To share God's word with you is such a blessing. And we trust that you are really being blessed by the word of God that we preach and teach. We're going to continue with our teaching on the baptism into the Spirit. And let's turn to Acts chapter 2, verse 17. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and on my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. Notice there distinctly that they shall prophesy is mentioned twice. The sons and daughters will prophesy in verse 17, and in verse 18, and they shall prophesy. Throughout our teaching on the baptism into the Holy Spirit, we have emphasized that the born-again experience graciously imparts the very nature of Christ. We become a new creation through the new birth. We also further emphasize that whatever the good Lord starts, He completes. There are no half measures whatsoever with God. And through the baptism into the Holy Spirit, we also receive the ministry of Christ. And that is, we become prophets, priests, and kings. So not only are we born of the Spirit, we are baptized into the Spirit. We have the born-again experience, which gives us the nature of God. And then through the baptism into the Spirit, we receive the three-folded cord anointing that cannot be broken, and that being prophet, priest, and king. Now, having the nature of Christ and the ministry of Christ, we are more than a force to be reckoned with. We become more than a threat to the power of darkness. We have the power not only to disrupt the kingdom of darkness, we have the power to expel the darkness and switch on the glorious light of God's love and salvation provided for mankind through Jesus Christ. As the prophet Jesus, the Christ, we must remind ourselves what he preached of. Jesus preached salvation. He showed Israel and the world that there was a definite way out of the perplexities and dilemmas of life that sin causes. Jesus, as a prophet, shed forth the light of God's glory on a dark and a perverse world. Not only did Jesus show Israel and the world the way to God, he openly declared he was the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to God the Father but through him. Then also, Jesus, as a prophet, predicted the future. Now we need to consider Jesus as the priest. The Old Testament priest was required to offer up sacrifice for himself and for the people. But in the case of Jesus, this was not necessary for the simple reason that the Bible says that though Jesus was tempted in every fashion like all men, yet was he without sin. The high priest of the Old Testament offered up sacrifice for both himself and the nation of Israel, but not Jesus. Other than that, Jesus did not offer up sacrifice. He was the sacrifice. He offered up himself. He was the very Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world. Jesus offered up himself. He cried, I laid down my life for the sheep. No wonder John the Baptist cried, Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Jesus as King rules through the hearts of men as they accept Him as Lord and Savior. As King, there is coming a day that Jesus will literally sit upon the throne of David. As King, Jesus puts to flight the false king, and that is Satan, the very enemy of mankind. Now, how does this all apply to you and I who are baptized into the Holy Spirit? Now, like our Savior, through the baptism into the Spirit that makes us prophets of God, we too are called to preach salvation. And through preaching salvation to lost humanity, we, through the Word of God and the anointing of the Holy Spirit, we break the stranglehold that Satan has over mankind. As prophets like Jesus, we shed forth the light of God's glory to all those living in darkness, in the darkness of sin and shame. We point them to the light of the world, and that is even Jesus the Christ. As prophets, we cancel out the lies of Satan's demons and men, and we declare the truth that salvation can only be experienced through Jesus Christ. As prophets like Jesus, we also predict the future. Now, let's consider our priesthood. As priests before God, we represent mankind. Our lives are no more lived for self and self-gratification. We have died to self. Our living as priests is for the glory of God and the betterment of mankind. As baptized into the Holy Spirit, as priests likened unto the priesthood of Jesus, we too give our life for the sheep. In fact, this is what Jesus really taught at the Last Supper. Let's turn to Luke chapter 22, verse 19. And I want to impart some illumination this morning to you concerning the table of the Lord. Luke chapter 22 and verse 19. Trust you are being blessed by this. 22 verse 19. And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Now, let's go to the revelation that Paul the Apostle had received. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 11. And verse 23. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you, this do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when it supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, this do he as oft as he drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. I purposely read both scriptures for the simple fact that both Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me, and Paul says likewise, do this in remembrance of Jesus. Now, we've got to ask ourselves, what is the Lord speaking of when he says, do this in remembrance of me? No doubt, when we consider the table of the Lord, also known as Holy Communion, we have the understanding that when we break bread, we are no doubt thinking of what was accomplished at the cross of Calvary, Christ giving his life for depraved humanity. Now, what we have done over all these centuries is that week after week, time after time, we reenact the table of the Lord. We reenact the table of the Lord in the sense that we go through the process of Holy Communion. We have communion not only with the Lord, but we break bread and we share in communion together. And the thought that I want to convey to you is this. Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. And the emphasis that you and I lay on and emphasize is the whole communion table. It's the breaking of the bread, the eating of the bread, the pronouncement of the whole happening there. But we fail to understand what Christ is saying when he says, do this in remembrance of me. Now, I personally believe that Christ gave himself for depraved humanity. There's no other way to find salvation but through the cross of Calvary. And Jesus is saying there, the way I give my life for fallen humanity, he is saying that you and I ought to do likewise for fallen humanity. Let me read a scripture that is found in 1 John chapter 3, verse 16. Now, the Lord gave me a wonderful thought this morning. You know, John 3, 16 is the most famous Bible, a famous verse in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, that is John 3:16. Now, let me read to you the scripture that I believe must become the second most verse of the Bible. The first most famous verse is John 3:16. Now, the second most famous verse, it's found in 1 John 3:16. And it says this, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. I want to read that again. 1 John 3:16. Hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. Now, at the communion table, at the Last Supper, Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. The emphasis was not towards the breaking of the bread and the drinking of the wine. That was but an analogy pointing to the death of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary as he gave his life for depraved humanity. Hereby, perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life. Remember, I read the verse, no man takes my life. I lay down my life for the sheep. And this is what Jesus wants you and I to do in remembrance of him. What we do? Oh, we have a great communion celebration around the table of the Lord. And in most churches, you know, the minister gets up. He's well-dressed that Sunday, collar and tie. Oh, and the glory is all around the table. But the emphasis is just on the bread and the wine. It's not on what Christ is asking you and I to do. And what is he asking you and I to do? I read the scripture again. The second most famous scripture in the Bible. In fact, it must become your second most famous scripture and my most second famous scripture. Hereby, be saved with the love of God, because he laid down his life. Listen to what the next part says. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. And we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. In other words, Jesus said this, do this in remembrance of me, as I give my life as a living sacrifice for depraved humanity. You likewise do the same. Amen. Our whole life as born again, Holy Ghost baptized Christians should be a life of sacrifice. And I'm telling you this, my brother and my sister, it's one thing to be a prophet of God, but it's another thing to be a priest of God. Our whole life is to emulate the life of Christ. And through the baptism into the Holy Spirit, God gives us the power to live a sacrificial life, that we die to ourselves and we re-echo the words of Paul. It's not I that live anymore, but Christ that lives within me. Christ who laid down his life, who was empowered by the Spirit of God to give his life a ransom for lost humanity. Oh, hallelujah. And I believe it's one thing to have the mind of Christ, but it's another thing to have the heart of Christ. Hallelujah. Christ gave his life. And you know, it's not surprising if you couple that verse with Acts 1:8, and you shall be witnesses. What you must understand is this, and we spoke of it. The word there, witness, is derived from the Greek word martyrs, from which we derive the word martyr. You know, it's more than just speaking in tongues. And like you, we pray, I pray in tongues. But my brother and my sister, one of the purposes of the baptism into the Spirit of God is that we live a sacrificial life. We stop living for ourselves and we start living for the glory of God and for the benefit of mankind. No wonder Paul says, I don't live, but Christ lives in me. The way, if you read the life of Paul, the way Jesus gave his life, Paul gave his life. His whole life was for the living of the glory of his Lord and Savior. So I trust that what I've just shared with you is a blessing. John 3:16, the most famous verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. And Jesus said, no man takes my life, I lay down my life for the sheep. And Jesus says, if we love the brethren the way he loved the brethren, then we ought to lay down our life for the brethren. Hallelujah. Like I said, it's one thing to be a prophet, but it's another thing to be the priest of God. The prophet has the mind of God. He represents God to the people. He's God's spokesperson to the people. And everybody wants to be a prophet these days. And very few want to be priests of God. For the priest does not represent God to the people. Rather, the priest represents the people to God. The priest is not God's spokesman. Rather, they are the spokesmen of the people. Now, for you and I to better grasp and understand this wonderful purpose of being baptized into the Spirit, which makes us prophets, priests, and kings, we need to go back to the Old Testament. And I want to show you the importance and the responsibility of you and I being part of the priesthood. Let's go to Exodus chapter 28. And we read from verse 2. Chapter 28, verse 2, yes. 28. Exodus chapter 28 and verse 2. And thou shalt make holy garments for Aaron, thy brother, for glory and for beauty. Now notice, the garments are for glory and beauty. And thou shalt speak unto all that are wise-hearted, whom I have filled with the spirit of wisdom, that they may make Aaron's garments to consecrate him, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office. And these are the garments which they shall make: a breastplate, and an ephod, and a robe, and a broidered coat, a mitre, and a girdle. And they shall make holy garments for Aaron thy brother and his sons, that he may minister unto me in the priest's office. Now, let's read about the garments for the ephod and the girdle. Verse 5. And they shall take gold and blue, purple, scarlet, and fine linen. And they shall make the ephod of gold, of blue, and of purple, of scarlet, and of fine twined linen with cunning work. It shall have two shoulder pieces thereof joined at two edges thereof, and so it shall be joined. And the curious girdle of the ephod which is upon it shall be of the same according to the work thereof, even of gold, of blue, and purple, and scarlet, and fine twined linen. And thou shalt take two onyx stones and grave on them the names of the children of Israel, six of the names on the one stone, and six on the other, six names of the rest of the other stone according to their birth, with the work of engraver in stone, like the engravings of a signet. Thou shalt engrave the two stones with the names of the children of Israel. Thou shalt make them to be set in arches of gold. And thou shalt put the two stones upon the shoulders of the ephod for stones of memorial unto the children of Israel. And Aaron shall bear the names before the Lord upon his two shoulders for memorial, and thou shalt make them arches of gold, and two chains of pure gold at the ends of wreathen work shall they make them, and fasten the wreathen chains to the arches. Before I read any further, this speaks of the ephod, that garment that hung from the shoulders of Aaron the high priest. God is speaking to you and I prophetically. Bear in mind, I'm emphasizing that the prophet represents the mind of God. He's God's spokesman. He speaks on behalf of God. He's God's representative as such. But now notice the garments of the priest. On the ephod, two shoulder pads are made of gold. And on each shoulder pad engraved are six names of the tribes of Israel. Six on the left, six on the right. Amen. Now, where are they? They're on the shoulders of Aaron, the high priest. Remember, I read the scripture, the second most famous verse of the Bible now to you and I. We ought to lay down our life for the brethren. And what Aaron is picturing here, what prophetical analogy is given here, is nothing less that we become the burden bearers of our brothers, carrying each other's burden. Where is it? It's on our shoulders. The weight of our brother's problems and sins and dilemmas and perplexities and sickness and diseases are upon our shoulders. And it weighs us down as the priest of God. And when we stand before God as priests, we are the burden bearers bearers, not only of the church, but we are the burden bearers of the world. We represent their pain to God. And we speak to God on behalf of those who we carry upon our shoulders. Hallelujah. That's the priesthood, my brother. You are a burden bearer, caring one for the other, carrying each other's burdens. So I trust you see that prophetical insight of the word there. Let's now go to the breastplate. And this is wonderful. Verse 15 of the same chapter. And thou shalt make the breastplate of judgment with cunning work. After the work of the ephod, thou shalt make it of gold, of blue, and of purple, and of scarlet, and of fine twined linen shalt thou make it. Four square it shall be double. A span shall be the length thereof, and a span shall be the breadth thereof. And thou shalt set it in settings of stones, even four rows of stones. The first row shall be a sardius, a topaz, a carbuncle. This shall be the first row. And the second row shall be an emerald, a sapphire, and a diamond. And the third row, a legia, an agate, an amethyst. And the fourth row, a beryl, an onyx, and a jasper. And they shall be set in gold in their enclosings. And the stone shall be with the names of the children of Israel, 12 according to the names, like the engravings of a signet. Everyone with his name shall they be according to the 12 tribes. And thou shalt make upon the breastplate change at the ends of written work of pure gold. Amen. I hope you get the picture. Now, notice all the minerals, gold, you name it, onyx and whatnot, emeralds, all are there. And upon these minerals are engraved the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. It's carried on the breastplate. On the breastplate. And when you are baptized into the Holy Ghost and you receive the ministry of Christ as a prophet, as a priest, and a king, when you receive this priesthood ministry, God would want you, my brother and my sister, to have his people, the church of God, upon your heart, that day in and day out you stand before God and you represent these people. You intercede on their behalf. Your life is filled with their pain and their sorrow, and you go to God that they might be delivered and become blessed of the Lord. Hallelujah. You are a priest. Hallelujah. Likened unto Jesus. Oh, I trust that you understand what the Spirit of God is saying to us this morning. It's one thing to be a prophet and praise God, but it's another thing to be a priest. That prophet speaks the mind of God, but that priest expresses the heart of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Christ laid down his life. And God wants you and I to live a similar life, that our life be nothing less than a sacrifice. Then last but not least, we also baptized into the ministry of kingship. Amen. We are a royal priesthood. Revelation 1:6 says that we are kings. Amen. Kings. And our kingship is likened unto the ministry of our king. It's an honor and a privilege to be called a prophet, a priest, and a king of the Most High God. You know, it's wonderful to note what John the Baptist preached. He preached the kingdom of God is at hand. Jesus preached the self same message. The kingdom of God is at hand. And many people wrangle, debate about the kingdom of God. But to me, the kingdom of God is so simple. It's the rule of God. It's the R-U-L-E, the rule of God in the life of man. And this is what we're called to do. We are called by God through our prophetical, our priestly, our kingly anointing to convey to people through the gospel that no longer they need to be controlled and dictated by and unto by Satan, the false king. They can know the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords because his kingdom is at hand. And all they need to do to become a part of this impending kingdom, for them to experience the rule of God, all they need to do is to accept Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. This kingdom is a kingdom of blessing. It's a kingdom of hope where sin and sickness does not rule. It's a kingdom of joy unspeakable and full of glory. My brothers and my sisters, the baptism into the Holy Spirit lays a responsibility upon you. Not that we just speak in tongues, and let's do so every day, every moment of the day. Let's make melody in our heart. Let's pray, let's sing in tongues, let's pray in tongues. But my brother, does not forget, that is but the initial evidence of having receiving the baptism into the Holy Spirit. There are other ongoing evidences that tells us that we are filled with the Spirit. And one of the ongoing evidences is that we are prophets, we are priests, and we are kings. And I close with this. Remember I said, the prophet has the mind, the priest has the heart, and the king has the authority. Amen. And for you to have authority against the powers of darkness, if you are to put on the light of God's glory and cancel out the darkness, if you are to bring the rule of God to depraved humanity, then you must live the life of the prophet and as the priest. Take the mind and the heart and join them together. Live in the presence of God. Die to yourself. Live for the glory of God and for the betterment of humanity. And the anointing that breaketh the yokes of bondage, the kingly anointing, will be your daily expression. May God bless you. May God keep you. And may the joy and peace of God, which passes all human understanding, be your daily experience. God bless you. God keep you. Brother Ian has reminded me last week and this week. And by the way, thanks for praying for me. I'm much better. My wife is also much better. Thanks for your prayers. But keep on praying for us. Ian has been reminding me that we some or the other, not him, because he's reminding me, that I have to do one more video on discrimination. And he's probably right. I need to further elaborate on the ministry of the woman in the church. I need to also do a teaching on the role of the young people in the church and the old men in the church. So there is one more video that we need to do on discrimination. So I want to thank Ian on that. Amen. He's just not just videoing, he's praying, doing his work, but he's also keeping a good tab on me. He knows that the old man's getting old and becoming forgetful. But God bless you, God keep you. So we will do our best next week to do another video on discrimination. We will deal extensively with the role of the woman in the church. And no doubt we have to touch on what Paul writes on, suffer not a woman to teach, but we're going to explain what it really means. And then also we will teach on the role of the young people in the church and the old people in the church as such. God bless you. Receive a benediction. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you. And the Lord flood your inner being with the anointing of the Spirit of God that breaketh the yoke, making you to be a prophet, a priest, and a king. And all God's people said, amen. God bless. See you next week. Amen. Wait for the video on marriage. Amen.